I'd like to welcome you to our Inspiration Wednesday session. Today's session is all about building better courses in less time, of course, using our latest and greatest Lectora V11. Now, this was my presentation that I presented at this year's Lectora User Conference in San Antonio. So for those of you on the call that didn't get to go this year, didn't get to attend, this is going to be some of the content that was presented there. Those of you that were maybe in San Antonio but sat in on another session, I guess I won't be too offended, but same good information for you all the same. Now, what I'd like to do in this presentation is, certainly moving forward, I'm going to hit the highlights of that LUC presentation. We don't have an hour and a half like we did at the user conference, so I'm going to pull out some of the best pieces from the presentation and give that information to you. But overall, what we're going to do is focus on specific version 11 features that are really going to help cut down that development time for you. Now, for those of you that have been around for quite some time, that you've been using Lectora maybe several versions back, you probably recognize that our latest release has been our biggest one yet, and most of our changes going to the interface design. But our goals for version 11 were really, really simple. We wanted to cut down on development time, we wanted to increase usability, and we definitely wanted to create a more intuitive interface. And hopefully that's what we've done with V11. We added a lot of really nice objects, social buttons, widgets, a new timer object. And what we really tried to do is shed a greater light on some of the objects and options that might have already been in the product, but maybe you weren't aware of, maybe you didn't know they existed. So that's what we tried to do with version 11. Those were some of our goals going into the redesign. Now, during today's presentation, what I'm going to do is I'll work to build a sample title. I'll build a partial title out, and the topic's all about the city of San Antonio. And of course, the entire title has been built with specific version 11 features and functionality. Just like all of our Inspiration Wednesday sessions, this is being recorded. This will be available in just a few days out on our website. So if this is your first time joining one of these sessions, they are all recorded. We've got about 100 archived videos out on our site right now. So definitely a good resource to take advantage of at a later date. What I'd like to do to start the presentation is just give you an idea of some of the sample content that you'll see me building throughout the presentation. So that way you'll just have a little bit more working knowledge as to some of the content we'll be building and introducing some of those V11 features. So if you take a look, this is just a course that we built. It's all about San Antonio, which is where we hosted this year's user conference. A couple elements that we'll introduce you to. Number one, you can see this design theme. We'll spend some time talking about the advantages of utilizing those design themes. You can see there's a character on my page. Very easily can you modify character positions. We made that much more accessible in version 11. And I'm certainly not going to go through each and every page within my content, but I will point out a couple new features. We'll spend some time talking about a new action called our Open Attachment action. This is a really nice way to provide additional information, Word documents, PDF documents, etc. So you can see here when I open that attachment, in this case it's launched in its own separate window or tab, and when I'm done reviewing that information, I can simply close out and I remain in the same position within my course content. A couple other features we will touch base on today. We'll talk about some of our new social object features. You can pull in, for example, an RSS feed. And here we have just articles all about San Antonio. And on the right-hand side, we chose to follow a specific user on Twitter. And there's a user called Visit San Antonio. And we're just pulling in some specific news feed from that user's account. So a lot of nice social media elements we can now add in version 11. And you can do that very quickly. On the Spurs page, I'm going to show you how you can take advantage of our new timer object. This one's kind of a small one that you may or may not have noticed even went into the latest release, but it's a really cool feature. What you can do, number of different things. With this object, we chose to create a little activity using a drag and drop question. And basically, when we start our timer, it kind of looks like a shot clock for us. So if you're wondering what that 24 seconds was for, that's the shot clock in basketball. I had to Google that to find it out. And you can score submitting your question. You can generate question feedback if you had that set up here. Number of different things you can do there. So I'm not going to spend a whole great amount of time going through this completed title because that's not what you want to see. You want to see how it was built and you want to dive into Lectora. So let's go ahead and open up Lectora. And you can see on my screen that I'm going to work off of a partially created title. So this is that San Antonio title that I'm going to be building and adding different elements to. So the first thing I want to spend some time talking about are these new design themes. Now with version 11, we have over 75 themes that you can use with your titles. Themes are great for a couple different reasons. Number one, they provide you with a nice professional and stylish look and feel to your course. So if you're someone who's wearing all the hats and you don't have graphic resources always available to you, this is going to be a huge advantage. So let's say, for example, that I wanted to continue using this silver design theme that you can see is currently applied to my title. The first thing I might logically do is probably change out this logo. This is just kind of a standard placeholder for my logo image. And I want to update this and make this a little bit more realistic with my course content. So I'll double-click the image, opening the image properties, and I'll browse for a file. In this case, I have one out on my desktop. And I've got this new logo image that I want to use instead, and I'll go ahead and update that. So logically, that's probably the first thing I would change with that design theme. The second thing, I'd probably want to rename the course title. So I might call this course San Antonio Fun and Facts. Now I could go through and continue developing this course. You can see here that some of the pages are developed, some of them are not. So you can kind of see an example of both. And I can be making changes as necessary, etc., etc. Let's say you're halfway through development of your project and you decide to show this to your boss. And you say, hey, take a look at the project, let me know what you think. And your boss says, wow, Tara, this looks great, but we know there's always a but. So she says, but, you know, I really don't love that silver theme that you've got going. Maybe we can change it to red. I think that'll look a little bit nicer. Now, in the past, if you were using something like a template, you know that this could be a big, giant pain because probably your graphics have been already created. They've been created for this specific project. And now she's telling you to delete them all out and go create new ones. Not the case if you're going to use a design theme. So let's say, okay, I'm going to listen to my boss and I'm going to change this design theme. All you have to do is go back to your design ribbon. This is where you have a list of over 75 different themes that you can utilize. And let's assume that you want to change this to the red. So same style, but just a different color. So when I select my design theme, it automatically swaps out the theme graphics with the new selection. Now what you're noticing is that because I've already updated my logo and my course title, that has automatically stayed and remained consistent. So that's going to be a nice time saver for you. If you change your mind halfway through development of a project, it's as easy as the click of a mouse to change out that theme. And the only thing that's really happening, if you look over here in your Title Explorer, there are a number of theme graphics and navigation buttons, etc., that come in with that theme. So when you select a new one, it's just swapping them out for the new style. Now the other advantage, aside from this giving you a nice professional look and feel to your course, the other advantage to this is course size. I know that, you know, the new talk is all this mobile. We're creating content that can be accessed from our mobile devices, our smartphones, our tablets, etc. Well, if you wanted to create this course at a different size, if you're using a design theme, the theme will automatically reflect to the new size that you set your course. Now, obviously, the pages that you've created and some of the objects that you've already built into your project will have to be resized and reset to your new design, but the design theme can go from your standard size courses for your tablets, your PCs, we can go to your smartphone size, your Androids, your iOS devices, etc. So a lot of really nice advantages to using those design themes. Now, staying up here at this design ribbon, this is something that I just want to make sure I point out to you. With version 11, your design ribbon, any of the changes that you make here are going to be applied to your entire title. So if you use previous versions of Lectora, the design ribbon sort of takes place of those old title properties, where here you can set the course size, you can set your page alignment, you can choose all your styling options, set your default text styles, your hyperlink colors, etc. So that design ribbon, keep that in mind. This is sort of a one-stop shop for kind of styling out your entire project. But keep in mind that that will inherit throughout the rest of the content. All right, so still working up here at the title level. I'm just going to delete out some of the objects there to kind of refine my design a little bit. Next thing I want to introduce you to are our new smart text objects. So if I go over to my insert ribbon, on the left-hand side of the ribbon, you have this new panel called Add Text. And certainly here's where you can just add a text block by default and begin typing in if you prefer. But what I'm going to show you are these new elements here. These are what we call our smart text. Now, if anyone has taken training with me before or any of the other trainers, you know that we do an exercise in the intermediate class where we created a breadcrumb. In previous versions of Lectora, this took a lot of work. You had to create a text block, a couple different actions, you worked with the variables, etc., etc. Now, what's a breadcrumb? A breadcrumb, basic definition, is just a trail of information for your learners. It's just going to show them what chapter they're in, maybe what section they're in, and then the page name that they're currently on. So if you want that information displayed throughout the title, up here at my title level, I can just click this breadcrumb icon, and what it does for me is it adds a text block to my page. And if you look in the Title Explorer, you see it has a number of actions associated with the text block. What this functionality will do for me is automatically pull in my chapter, my section, and my page names. So for example, if I'm on the humor page in my entertainment chapter, you can see it's pulled in the chapter name, and then it's pulled in the page name. I'm not in a section, so there is no section name. So that's a really easy way to add that element to your entire title. And now it's just as easy as the click of your mouse to add that functionality in. So if you took training with us a few years ago, you're probably saying, oh my goodness, that exercise used to take about 25 minutes to create all those actions and get that text block, and now all that functionality is done for you. Just as easy to add the current date or the current time to your project. So if I wanted to add the current date, and this just pulls it in from the user's computer setting. I forgot to delete the one that I put in this morning. But you can modify that. And it looks like I placed this on the page. Let me move that up a little bit. And all this is a text block. And you could modify the look and feel of the font because this is just a placeholder. So obviously, that font color is not going to work for me. So I can change out the color and maybe give it a white font so it looks a little bit better. So a lot of nice options with those smart text objects, and they can be found directly from your insert ribbon. Now let's move to our welcome page. So here we have our page level, and let's assume we want to add a character to this page level. Now characters were in previous versions of Lectora, but we've made them much more accessible for V11. So if I want to add a character, I'm going to go to my insert ribbon. And here's a good tip here. 90% of what you might be looking for in terms of adding objects to your project, images, video files, audio files, etc., can be found directly from this insert ribbon. So if you kind of find yourself wondering, oh, which ribbon do I need to choose for that? If you're looking to add an object, try the insert ribbon first. And then you'll quickly realize where everything else is located. But to get you started, that's a good tip. So I'm simply going to select this character icon. I'll select that here. Notice as soon as I do that, on the right-hand side, we have this new media library come into focus. And it's focused on this stock library section. In the stock library is where we have all of our character poses. And our characters are simply categorized by the position they can be moved into. You can choose male, female characters, different occupations, lots of different options. I'm going to start by choosing one of the characters that's waving, I'm going to look to add the character Liz onto my page, and I'll select OK. I can resize her a little bit so she fits on the page where I want. Now, the nice thing about these characters, think a little bit deeper than, okay, great, I just saw how easy it was to add a character, but think about what that can do for you in terms of instructional design. If you're creating self-paced e-learning content, we know that the learner is sitting on the other side of their PC, they're going through this material, there's no facilitator or instructor to ask questions to. So including a character or a coach or a guide, someone that's going to take them through the content, provide feedback, pop up with tips and tricks, that's a great way to really connect your learner into the content itself, to really engage them. So keep that in mind. In terms of using characters, yeah, use them. Integrate them all throughout your course. Now you saw how easy it was to add a character to the page. Let's show you how easy it is to change their position. So let's say, when the user clicks this submit button, I want to change her position from waving to, let's say, the thumbs up sign. So I'm going to open up the action that's attached to the button. You can see my action properties right up at the top. Actions are easy in Lectora, just read them left to right. First thing I always like to do is just create an action name. So I might just call this change position. When the learner clicks the button, so I'll leave the trigger mouse click, let's take a look at some of our actions. Actions have changed for version 11. You'll notice here from this action dropdown, we no longer are simply alphabetizing the actions. In old versions of Lectora, used to come through and all the actions were alphabetized. And that was really great if you were an existing Lectora user, if you already knew Lectora and kind of knew what to expect and knew the name of the action you were looking for. Well, now we've made this a lot easier, and instead of alphabetizing, we've broken down the actions by category. So here, you can find actions that are associated with navigation, actions that can be applied to objects, commands that you can execute in Lectora, etc., etc. So I really think this helps you focus in more on the functionality that you're looking to create, and that makes it much easier to find that functionality. So for this example, we'll choose the action called Set Character Pose. My target pre-populates because I have one character on the page level. And for my new position, we can go ahead and select any one of these positions, but I'll go ahead and use that thumbs up sign. And if we want to preview this out, we know we can't do it here in edit mode, so let's take a look in preview mode. And here we can enter my name in the field, and when my learner clicks that submit button, the character's position will automatically change. Now hopefully there's not a lag time from the GoToMeeting session that we're having, but to your learner's perspective, to my perspective, that position changes absolutely immediately. So it's a nice seamless transition from the waving sign to the thumbs up sign. You can use these characters everywhere. I love to use them for question feedback. You get that whole visual element in there. You know, thumbs up if they answer the question correct, thumbs down if it's incorrect, sad, happy, tons of emotions that you can use there. So keep those characters in mind. They will definitely add another level of engagement to your course content. Now, something that our learners have been asking for a long time now is the ability to change the properties of more than one object at the same time. So we've definitely listened and we've implemented that into version 11. So let's assume that I want to take these two text blocks, the San Antonio Fun and Facts and maybe my breadcrumb, and I want to modify their properties to have, let's say, a different background color. Using my control key, I can select both of those objects, and up here from the text properties, one time, let's say I want to change the background color to gray. I do that once, and since both of those objects were selected, it changes immediately for both of them. Now I'll go ahead and reset that back because I don't want those to remain gray. If you select objects of a different type, for example, let's select this text block on the page and my character, so an image and a text block. Look up top in my interface. You get this new multiple objects property ribbon. And if you've selected objects that are different types, so here I've got an image and a text block, you can only change those common elements that the two share. So for example, I can set both of these to be on the top layer. I can hide them both initially, modify their transitions, and of course I can modify their position and size. I won't be able to modify text colors because both of them don't have text options, so that sort of thing. So very nice, very helpful, especially when you start working on pages that have multiple layers and you're showing and hiding different objects. Objects need to be on the top, hidden, etc. So keep that in mind. That will drastically cut down your development time. You don't have to change each object individually. Another time saver that our users were asking for is we've given you the ability to use your tabbing function when you're up here within the ribbons. So for example, I've opened up the entry field properties, and if I want to tab to each of the options in here, I simply select my Alt key. You'll see as soon as I do that, I get some buttons here that just indicate that tabbing is now available, some shortcut keys. And if I click my tab, let me go in here again, click my tab key, it's going to tab to each of the options that are available within this ribbon. So again, that's going to cut down your development time. It's also going to save you a little wrist action, so maybe you won't have that carpal tunnel as soon as you thought you might have it. Another V11 feature that I definitely want to introduce you to can be found from the Tools ribbon. On the Tools ribbon, we now have the ability to import directly from your PowerPoint presentations. Now, the nice thing about version 11 is that this is now included within the application. Previous versions of Lectora, this was a separate tool. It was an additional tool that you had to purchase in order for this functionality. Well, now, let's assume I've got some content already created on PowerPoint slides, and everybody's got content in PowerPoint. You've got good content, good documentation, good graphics, and you really want to tap into those resources and utilize them. Well, the benefit here is that now you can pull them directly into Lectora, and now using Lectora, you can make that content come to life, make it more interactive, make it more engaging, using all of Lectora's tools and functions. So if I want to import a PowerPoint, I'm going to come here, select the import icon, and the first thing Lectora is going to ask me to do is to select the PowerPoint file from my machine, so I'll do that here. It's going to generate all the slides of the presentation, and I'm just using a simple example here, so I have only 3 slides. You can select which slides you want to import in, so you don't have to take all of the slides if you don't want to. When you select Next, here's where you can determine your title size. So you can choose from one of the default size options, or you can customize your own specific size as well. You can determine if you want to import PowerPoint transitions and what format you want those images from your PowerPoint slides to come in as. Now here's the nice thing. When I select Finish, it's going to import the slides that I've selected. And without me doing anything else, take a look on the left-hand side of my screen into that Title Explorer. An entirely separate chapter has been created called PowerPoint Slides. You'll see at the chapter level a couple of your standard PowerPoint actions have come in, so advancing by spacebar or by enter. You can always delete those out. And now each slide from your PowerPoint presentation is its own page in your Lectora project. Any of the text and the graphics are now individual objects that you can easily manipulate within Lectora. Now, this certainly doesn't look like the rest of my course, so if I go into the chapter properties, I can very simply inherit those objects from my title level, and now these slides are looking much more like the rest of my content. Now, if I needed to reposition these pages, I can just select those here, and I can drag and drop and maybe reposition them in a different chapter. And these would probably go better off in my history chapter, so I can reposition them accordingly. So now certainly I can modify my text and my fonts, make any changes that I wanted to, because all of this content now is simply objects in Lectora. So a lot of nice functionality there. I think the benefit of that PowerPoint import tool is not only to get that existing content, start utilizing that existing content, but think of the implications here. Let's say you work with a subject matter expert who knows nothing about Lectora development. Maybe they're the subject matter expert, maybe they're the instructional designer. You can have them building out this content, pulling in the graphics and the documentation, making sure everything's correct in PowerPoint, an application that they know, and then you can import those slides into Lectora for the development phase. So there's a lot of implications for this. I know internally we like to create a lot of our storyboards with PowerPoint, because if we ever need to use, you know, a client who's not familiar with the development side of Lectora, we can have them review that content in PowerPoint, because everyone knows PowerPoint, and then we can take that, import it into our title, and continue on with the development process. So a lot of really great implications for that. It's now built directly into your Lectora application, so no additional resources needed. Now, speaking of our next development tip here, take a look at the top left-hand corner of my interface, and you'll see a couple of icons here. And this is what we call our Quick Access Toolbar, or we like to also call it the QAT. This is where you can populate and customize this with your most used commands. So for example, let's say you find yourself constantly using this PowerPoint import tool. Well, what you could do is just add it to your Quick Access Toolbar so you don't always have to come into the Tools ribbon and select it from here. So any of the icons you find within these ribbons, you can right-click on them and you can choose this option, Add to Quick Access Toolbar. When you do that, you'll see it's listed right up here on the top left-hand corner. It's just as easy to remove an icon from that toolbar. You can right-click on the icon here and remove it. Now you've got some other options where maybe you want to show this toolbar below your ribbons, so it would kind of list right about here. You can really customize and use this any way that you like. So some of our clients, I've seen some clients create a Quick Access Toolbar that has tons of icons on it, and they keep it right here, so it's really at the top of their workspace. And then they don't have to go to each of the different ribbons. They've kind of got everything all in one. So there's a lot of different ways that you can use that. Flexibility is kind of the key here, so you've got a lot of flexibility. Now let's focus a little bit on the media library and some of the changes that went into version 11. If you take a look at the right side of your interface, you're going to see three tabs. This makes up your media library: your title resources, your My Library, and your Stock Library. When you hover over any of these, it's automatically going to slide out so you have easy access to all the content found within. Your title resources, simply put, this is showing you all of the content, the media, for example, that's already included within your title. So for example, if you've pulled in an image already, maybe somewhere else within the course, like here you can see my boot logo, if you wanted to reuse that anywhere else in your title, this makes it really easy because you can just drag and drop any of the items that you see here right onto your workspace. The stock library, this is where you can find your clip art graphics. We've got some stock media. All of your character poses can be found from here, different buttons you can add to your content, and some of your flash activities. So that's all found here. What I want to focus on is the My Library tab. This is where you can get a lot of power out of your Lectora application. What this area allows you to do, you can completely customize it, import all of your own graphics, your video files, your audio files, logos, callouts, you name it. Whatever content you're planning on using to develop out your title, you can store and categorize very easily here. This is nice because it will allow you to create a nice centralized storage location for all these files. And in terms of development, well, that's only going to cut down your development process, because now when you're saying, okay, I'm on this humor page and I need to add a video. Where is that video? Where did I save it? What file is it in? What folder is it in, etc.? If you take a little time in the beginning of your development process, do a little pre-planning, and you gather all the materials that you'll need to develop out your course, if you can locate or import those in here, that's going to make the process so much easier. So now, okay, I'm developing this humor page. I've got a video that I need to add to the page level. oh, I've already plugged it into here into my library, and I can just drag and drop it right onto my workspace. That's going to cut down development time, make things that much easier to locate, and just make that whole process go a little smoother. Now, it's just as easy to add objects to your library. So let's say, you know, you've got this boot logo here and you've pulled it into your title. You don't have it anywhere else. And you think to yourself, this is something I might use in another course, or I might find myself consistently using this object. You can right click on the object and choose this copy to my library. And it's automatically just going to copy it and place it right there within your library. So very easy to do. It's very easy to keep track of all of your content, all of your different objects. I see a quick note there in the chat room. Someone's asking when this version of Lectora is available. This is available now. We are working on Lectora version 11.1. So everything you're seeing here is already available to you. Okay, moving forward, let's go back to our title level. So I can show you something up there. We've made some changes to our menus in Lectora version 11, and now our menus can behave more like that table of contents with that page-based menu option. So let me show you what I mean by that. Let's assume I want to create a custom menu within this title. I'm at the title level, so I want it to be accessible on all the pages throughout. From the Insert ribbon, towards the center of the ribbon, you see this category called Add Navigation and Interaction. So from this panel, I'm going to select the menu icon. First thing you're going to notice, we've definitely made some nice changes here to creating your own menus, where now you have this nice preview window, which you didn't have available to you before. But the bigger tip here is you have this box you can select called Create Menu from Table of Contents. As soon as you select that, it's going to pull content in directly from your Title Explorer. If you remember in previous versions of Lectora, you had to add all of these items individually and rename them so they matched your actual Explorer, your actual structure. So if we select that option, notice immediately it pulls in all your chapter levels. And if we select Include Pages, now it's pulled in all of the pages as well. We make it very easy for you to disinclude certain areas that you wouldn't want accessible from that menu. So for example, my survey chapter, my test chapter, quiz results, pop-ups, and in this example, we'll take out those PowerPoint slides as well. So a lot of really nice options for very quickly creating a page-based menu based on the structure of your Lectora title. Now, in terms of setting up your actions, certainly when you do the page base, it's already set up in here to go to that specific page. So you do not have to plug all of that in yourself. That's going to be set up for you. In terms of styling, we have a couple nice style options for you. And let me go back here so you can see the menu as a whole. So for the menu style, the first thing you've got to select is the orientation. Do you want this menu horizontal? Do you want this vertical? Then you can set up your specific text style. So how do you want the text to look within this menu? You can set up the actual text color, the text rollover color. Maybe I'll go something a little darker when you roll over it, etc., etc. Modify the margins. And then, of course, you can modify the menu color. I might choose to set this to be transparent. You can always set it to be white, something like that. Menu rollover color, maybe when they roll over it, it'll turn gray. So I could spend all my time kind of setting up the different styles, but I think you get the idea here. Now the nice thing is you can also set your style for the submenu. And when I say submenu, I mean when you roll over, let's say, the history chapter, the page menus actually falls down. So that's your submenu. So when you set up that style, if you wanted it to be consistent with the main menu style, all you have to do is select this icon that says Set Submenu, and it automatically will lock in the same exact style. So it keeps a nice, consistent look and feel from your menu and your submenus. And when you select OK, you can see here's the menu that I just quickly created for our example. And of course, if we preview this out, you can kind of see the look and feel that we just set up there, and all of your navigation is automatically built in for you. So definitely want to take advantage of that new page-based menu style option. Now let's remain up here at the title level. And the next feature that I really want to focus on, this is new for 11.1. Those of you in the audience who are currently creating mobile content or contemplating creating mobile content, you're going to definitely want to take advantage of our new swipe left and swipe right action triggers. Now let's assume you're creating this content so it's accessible on the tablet. Imagine holding your tablet in front of you and any application that you're using on that tablet. If you want to navigate to the next page, you're swiping your finger to the left. If you want to navigate to the previous page, you're swiping your finger to the right. You can now implement that same functionality into your Lectora titles. So let's assume that I wanted to create this functionality so at the title level, so on each page the user could swipe left to go to the right, swipe right to go to the left, etc., etc. So what I'm going to do is at my title level, I'm going to add my first action, and I'm just going to call this first action swipe left. Now here's where we've added the new feature. From your action trigger drop-down, we have this new touchscreen category. So if I select screen swipe left, I always do this, I really have to visualize this, so I always pretend I'm kind of holding my smartphone in front of me, and I imagine with my finger, okay, if I'm swiping left, all right, that means I'm advancing the content. So my action would simply be go to next page. Now I can add a second action to the title level, and I'll just simply call this one swipe right. My action trigger this time would be screen swipe right. And my action would be to go to the previous page. If you apply these actions at the title level, like I've done here, they're automatically going to inherit down throughout the rest of your content. So now, if you publish this out and your learner is accessing it from a smartphone device or from a tablet, they'll be able to use that swipe navigation. So that's going to be a real big game changer in terms of creating your mobile content. It really just allows them, that learner, to seamlessly navigate forward and backward. All right, let's introduce you to a new action that we've created in Lectora, and this is called our open attachment action. Let's assume that on this page, I want to create a hyperlink so that when the learner clicks that hyperlink, we can launch a PDF document in a separate window. So in previous versions of Lectora, those of you who've worked with previous versions of Lectora, you'll remember, okay, this is where I have to add an additional file. I have to determine, depending on how I'm publishing out my content, what action do I use? Am I using the launch program or document? Am I using the go-to web address, et cetera, et cetera. So now we've completely redesigned this so it's much, much easier and much more of a no-brainer. So let me show you how this would work. From your insert ribbon, all the way on the right, this last panel over here, I'm going to select this attachment icon. Now you can choose to attach a single file or an actual folder. In this example, I'll choose to attach a file. And I'm going to select, I have a PDF document. You can see here, it's a PDF of the Riverwalk in San Antonio. It's just a map, so it's a nice graphic, a nice map of that whole area. Now, instead of just selecting open, what I can do in the same step is click this option that says create hyperlink to attachment on the page. What Lectora will automatically do for me is it will create a hyperlink just using the name of my file, and when the learner clicks on that hyperlink, it'll automatically execute this new open attachment action. So that saves you a lot of time. It's pulling the resource into your title, but at the same time, it's providing a way for the learner to access it. So when I select open, see what happens. It's created a text block with my hyperlink. And now if I can show you what the action is that's associated with the hyperlink, let me just double click on I'll double click one more time so you can see those properties. Here's our new action called Open Attachment, and by default, it automatically set up that PDF that I just pulled in. This is a really great resource. It allows you much quicker, much easier to add access to those additional resources, your Word documents, your spreadsheets, your PDF documents, etc. And you saw in my completed example earlier, so from this page, when the learner clicks on that hyperlink, we're just launching that PDF in a separate window, separate tab. And when they close out, they still remain in the same position within that course. So a nice, easy option. The new action here is that we've really simplified it from previous versions of Lectora. Open attachment, doesn't matter how you're publishing, that's the action that you're looking to use. Now, assuming here, when the learner clicks this hyperlink, we actually have a pop-up page that's created in my title. So let me go here to my pop-ups chapter. And I've got this SeaWorld page. It's empty right at the moment. So here, let's assume I want to show this pop-up window, and the pop-up window is going to have an embedded Google location. So let's embed a web window on this page level. If you go to your insert ribbon, all the way towards the right, you've got this Add Web Object category. I can select this icon called Web Window. Now, we've made it really easy for you to embed web content directly into your Lectora titles. Notice here, there are a number of window sources. You can add a specific URL, a page from your title, a Google Maps location, etc., etc. So in this example, let's just show you a Google Maps location, and we can pinpoint to SeaWorld in San Antonio, Texas. And as long as you've got an internet connection, you can do a nice preview of what that's going to look like. Now, any of these web windows that you're adding to your title, when you select OK, it will automatically just create a placeholder for you. So this is just a placeholder. If you go to edit, run, or preview mode, it's still going to look like a placeholder because this is a web object. If, however, you want to preview this out in a browser, and certainly once your content is published and you're viewing it in a browser, you'll be able to see exactly what that embedded web window is going to look like. So a lot of nice information here, a lot of nice easy ways. You don't have to use that external HTML anymore. We've made one very simple icon that you can access right from that insert ribbon. Couple more things I want to get through to make sure we cover some of the highlights from V11. Certainly not all of them, but we are trying to cover as many as possible. I'm going to head to my latest news page, and let's spend some time talking about social objects. Now, we know, especially in today's day and age, social objects are going to add relevance and real-life application to your content. Students are going to be much more inclined and much more engaged in a course or a topic if they can see that other people, maybe people in their field, are doing the same thing as they are. You can encourage discussion outside of the classroom by utilizing Facebook buttons, Twitter buttons, Google Plus buttons, etc. So first things first, on this page, let's say we want to embed an RSS feed. Now, I have a custom RSS feed here, so certainly you can have a custom blog or custom RSS feed that you find on a specific subject matter, something that's relatable to your content. And if you want to embed that into your course, you can select the RSS feed icon from your insert ribbon. Now, certainly if you wanted to pull in one of the popular feeds, ESPN, New York Times, you've got all of those listed right here. But if you have a custom feed, you select that, and I'm just going to paste in my feed that I took from my Word document and select OK. Now, with any of your web objects, Lectora is automatically going to create a placeholder. So this Thomas Edison is what you're always going to see, because something to note here is that any of these web objects, whether it's your RSS feed or it's a social object, the content is not going to be active unless your content is hosted out on a server. So once this is hosted on your server, in this example, like you saw from my completed course, let me pull this up here in the latest news page, this is going to pull in, that specific RSS feed is just pulling in specific articles all about the city of San Antonio. So this becomes active and live once my content is hosted. So this is currently hosted on a server. That's why all this is working here. Same thing with any of your Twitter functions, and we're going to pull this in a second. Once your content is hosted, this will automatically start populating and become active. So if you want to, let's say, add a Twitter feed. So notice you've got this social icon where you can add Twitter buttons, you can add Facebook buttons, you can do an all-in-one, which kind of gives you a little bit of each piece. So if you wanted to pull in, let's say, a feed widget, all you have to do is recognize the Twitter username. So I know there is one called Visit San Antonio. When I select OK, again, here's my placeholder. So this is just going to be a placeholder for me. But when my content is hosted and it's live, what this Twitter feed will allow me to do is anytime there's action or any active discussion going on with this particular user, you're going to pull in that conversation right here, and you've embedded it right into your Lectora title. So it's a great way to make your content relevant, to engage your learners, and really kind of generate that idea of taking that discussion outside of the classroom. So taking advantage of those social media elements, very easy to do. And the last thing I want to show you before we kind of wrap it up with our Q&A session, I'm sure Gina is firing questions and answers away over there. Let's take a look at this last page, and I want to introduce you to the new timer object. The timer object can be used a number of different ways. What we chose to do is create a really fun activity using some other Lectora objects. Like we're using a drag and drop question. So you remember from my completed course, let me just give you a refresh of what we wanted to do. Here's that game, that little activity, where we wanted to be able to, using this timer, set up all of the jerseys and kind of plug those into their correct spots. So let's show you how we did that in Lectora. This will just give you some good ideas on, you know, what other ways you can use the timer object instead of just the obvious, counting down, counting up, etc. So if we take a look from the insert ribbon, the first thing I've got to do is add a timer object to the page. So I'm going to go and select that here. You'll see it creates just a text block, a little placeholder, where my timer can be found. And now certainly I want to open up the properties here. There's a few things that I want to change or determine how I want my timer to be set up. First things first, I have to determine, do I want this timer to count down or count up? Definitely want it counting down to kind of recognize that shot clock scenario. I'm going to plug in the timing options here. I want it for 24 seconds to mimic the shot clock, and I do not want it to auto start. This means the timer would start counting down as soon as the learner got to the page level. So I don't want to do that. I want to let the learner decide when they're going to start answering this question. So I'll uncheck that for now. I only want to display the seconds, and then here I can even modify what that text block looks like. So maybe I'll change the background color to black. Maybe I'll change the text color to orange, make it bold, and make it a little bit larger. So definitely looks more like a basketball shot clock in my eyes anyway. All right, now you'll notice when you add the timer object, automatically there's an action associated with it. And if you look here within its action properties, the timer object uses that done playing trigger. So more or less it sort of acts like a media type, like a video or an audio file. So what we're telling Lectora is, okay, if we count down all the way to zero, what exactly do we want Lectora to do when that happens? Well, what we want to have happen is to process the question that's sitting on my page. So I've already got a drag and drop question already set up for us. So the action I'll choose is just going to be that one called process question. And it's going to pull in the drag and drop question that's on my page level. So that part is good. We know what's going to happen if we let the learner go all the way down and kind of drain out that clock. The next thing we need to do is we've got two buttons set up on our page, a start and a score. So attached to the start button, we have an action. And the first thing I need to do here is if they click the start button, we have to start the actual timer. So on mouse click, I'll choose the action called play, and I'll automatically pull in my timer object because that's the only media that can be found on the page. Now, there's only one other thing I need to have happen when the learner clicks the Start button. And if you can take a look here, I've placed a transparent button on top of those jersey images so that the question, the learner really can't start dragging those jerseys and start answering the question until they click and start that clock. So I'll add one more action here and say, when they click the Start button, let's also hide that transparent button. So that'll make those jerseys accessible to the learner. The last thing we need to do here is on our Score button, we need to do two things. First, we need to stop the timer, so I'll choose Stop, and it'll automatically pull in with my target of the timer object. And then the second action, in case the learner wants to answer the question earlier than, you know, waiting for the 24 seconds to pass, we'll also need to create that process question action here. So a couple different ideas here. We're just kind of show you this full activity so that you can really start generating some ideas on what you can do with that timer object. If I put this page in preview mode, you'll see here, I'm going to click my Start button. It's going to start counting down my clock, and then I'm free to modify and move these jerseys into the correct position. And don't judge, but I do have a cheat sheet, so I know where these should go. And when I click Score, notice I haven't let the time run out, so when I click Score, two things are happening. I'm processing the question, there's feedback built into the question, so that's what I'm seeing here, and then the clock is stopped and automatically goes back to 24 again. So a lot of nice things you can do. That's the new timer object that we've added in Lectora version 11. You can do a lot of really fun things with it, certainly create a lot of unique activities like we've done here. So this is just one way of using it. Certainly not the only way, but hopefully it kind of gives you something to think about, something to chew on for a while in terms of what you want to build into your own content. Okay, so at this point, I know we have about 7 minutes left of our presentation time today. So before I go over to the chat room and see if there are any questions that have been left unanswered by Gina, definitely want to remind you that like all of our Inspiration Wednesday sessions, this session is being recorded. It will be available, archived out on our site in just a few days. We have over 100 videos that are archived there right now. So if you haven't been able to sit in on a lot of sessions, you can't always make the live ones, not a problem. You'll always be able to find those there. If you sit in on a good one and think your colleagues might like it, it's always going to be available to you. Now, in addition to those archived videos, we have tons of free resources available on our website, which is just lectora.com. Check those out. We've got how-to courses you can download, and that'll give you the ability to really pick apart a title, how we built it, how we set it up, and you can really start seeing some of the actions and some of the ways that we utilize some of those functions and wizards and tools and objects.